ferritin sky high without hemochromatosis. Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode. Mark Silva says, hi, Chris. Thanks for all that you do. Lab work January 2020, ferritin 1264 nanograms per milliliter. That's very high. Percent saturation 33%. That's very normal. Iron total 122 micrograms per deciliter. Don't remember the range off the top of my head, but that seems fairly normal. Cholesterol 300 milligrams per deciliter. That's quite high. HDL 55. That looks quite low. So just 30 to 50 would be a ratio of 6. With 55, it's a little bit lower than that. But so you're 5 point something on the ratio. Well, 250. So if it was 275 to 55, that would be 5. So yeah, you're 5 point something on your ratio of total to HDL cholesterol, which is high risk. Trigs at 92, that looks good. It's fine. LDL at 164, that's high. So that was January 2020. Now we're looking at July 2021, so a year and a half later. Ferritin has gone from 1264 to 1111. Percent saturation has gone down to 21%. Iron total has gone up a little bit, 135 micrograms per deciliter. Cholesterol is similar. Mark continues. High sensitivity CRP, which is a marker of inflammation, is less than 0.3. GGT is 19 units per liter. I don't remember the range on that, but the GGT looks normal to me, and the HSCRP is very good. All other markers are in range. Healthy 35-year-old active male, no hemochromatosis variants detected on 23andMe. Also recently discovered, thanks to an MTHFR variant. Using your calculator, my methylfolate score is 73% decrease. I've been primarily eating nose-to-tail carnivore diet for several years, including eggs and dairy. Doctors are at a loss for what's going on. Well, so first of all, I think you were right to suspect inflammation given the high ferritin but the low saturation. Not low, but normal saturation. It does seem like you're not the best candidate for iron overload, given that your saturation is so normal. However, inflammation is not the only thing that raises ferritin. Oxidative stress is another major thing that raises ferritin, and you don't have any oxidative stress markers. But also, iron overload causes oxidative stress. And so, although an early case of iron overload, I would be more expectant of high saturation, maybe not so high ferritin, I think it's very reasonable that a more advanced case of iron overload could result in high ferritin and normal saturation just because the oxidative stress generated by the high iron, which is not generated by the high ferritin, it's generated by the high free iron, the high ferritin is telling you that you can infer that you probably have high free iron and the ferritin's acting in response to that. So that high free iron is generating high oxidative stress, which is then generating an increase in ferritin. So even though hemochromatosis generally involves a lack of sufficient ferritin response relative to the iron overload that you have, your oxidative stress is then kicking the ferritin into gear. So I don't think you can rule out that iron overload is your primary problem. Further than that, there's like 15 other genes besides HFE that account for like 5% of hemochromatosis cases, and there's no clinical test that captures all of them. So you can't rule out, you can rule in hemochromatosis with HFE genes, and you can get those tested on 23andMe, but you cannot rule out hemochromatosis with any commercially available genetic tests. So I don't think you can rule out that you have hemochromatosis even.
So I would say you need to investigate two things. One is, do you have oxidative stress? But a more elementary thing, the other thing, and the more elementary and basic thing to look at is, how does your ferritin respond to blood donation or phlebotomy? Because if donating blood or taking it out and throwing it away decreases your ferritin each time you do it and eventually goes back down to normal, then you solved your problem right there. Your problem is iron overload. And your negative HFE genes don't tell you otherwise. However, if that's not working, and particularly if you go anemic or something, right? So like if you donate blood and the ferritin is not responding the way you want it to, but your serum iron's going down and your iron saturation is going down below 30%, like it, you know, here it went down to 21%. So if it keeps going down further, and then even worse, your hemoglobin goes low and your red blood cell count goes low, then I think that sort of says, you know, maybe high iron is not the problem here. And maybe it's more likely to be a primary oxidative stress issue, meaning primary might not be the best word, but just with respect to iron metabolism, it isn't secondary to the iron overload. So that's kind of your two competing frameworks here are, you have a primary iron overload condition and a secondary oxidative stress response, or you don't have an iron overload problem. You have a primary oxidative stress problem, and that is creating the illusion of an iron overload problem. So I think the simplest thing to do is try blood donation or phlebotomy. See if the iron goes down without causing iron deficiency anemia. Iron deficiency anemia like markers. And if that doesn't work, then investigate oxidative stress. Best thing to do would be measure, get testing nutritional status, the ultimate cheat sheet, and measure everything in the oxidative stress section. You could start with, if you're going to get an Genova ion panel for the many reasons to get one, then the 8-hydroxy-2-deoxyguanosine and the lipid peroxides would be the best measures on that. I believe Quest and LabCorp both have independent lipid peroxide measurements. F2 isoprostanes is another marker that you could look at that, not sure if LabCorp and Quest have that, but the Boston Heart Lab has it. And LabCorp's whole blood glutathione test would be good to get. Although if you get the ion panel, you can get the glutathione that's on there. And then, you know, there's many other things in the cheat sheet, but that those would be the places to start just for the general question of, is there oxidative stress going on? But I wouldn't run out to get those until you test out the blood donation hypothesis first, because if you have iron overload, you will have oxidative stress. So the actual question is not, do you have oxidative stress? It's, do you have an iron overload condition? And so see if the iron markers respond the way you think they should to the blood donation / phlebotomy approach first. Because if they do, if that responds the way you want it to, then the oxidative stress might just fall into place. Whereas if it doesn't, then you might have to deal with the oxidative stress directly, figure out what its causes and deal with that. In terms of the high cholesterol, the oxidative stress and particularly the iron could be elevating it, but you're on a carnivore diet, and so it's common for people on a carnivore diet to develop high cholesterol, and you might need to increase your fiber intake or something like that. All right, hope that helps, Mark. Thank you for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, The Ultimate Cheat Sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.